Hello everybody, welcome again to this next session of Great Experiments in Psychology. In today's class, we will discuss about how psychology was established as a science. In the previous class we have talked about how philosophy had its psychology had its roots in philosophy, and how the philosophical changes in the world brought about a movement in developing psychology and establishing psychology as a science. In today's class, we will talk about the famous biologists, physiologists and medical practitioners who actually involved psychological counterparts in their work, and that is how brought about the new science of psychology. The beginnings of experimental psychology started with empirical philosophy. We discussed that in the previous section, and we saw that there was a zeitgeist or an intellectual movement that was taking place all across the world, especially in Europe. Now, what was happening in Europe was there was a scientific revolution going on, and there was this revolution represented the beginning of enlightened thought. And during the 17th and 18th centuries, people started having more confidence in human reason and experience instead of faith in religion and traditional authority. So they were asking questions. They were asking questions about the natural phenomena. They were asking questions about why there were different behaviors in humankind, why people behaved in a certain way, why certain physical and physiological experiences came about. And this made these questions brought about various changes in the world of science. And so the first experimental psychologists were primarily physiologists from Germany. We talked about physiology having a major role in the development of psychology in the last class. We also saw how physics had an importance in developing psychology as a science. Today, we are going to discuss the four major people who had influenced the development of psychology as a science. And they are Hermann von Helmholtz, Ernst Weber, Gustav Fechner, and Wilhelm Wundt. Most of us know of Wundt as the father of modern psychology. In our following classes today and in the next class, we will discuss as to why is it important to understand the role of Helmholtz, Weber and Fechner in the development of psychology, and how and why is Wundt called the father of modern psychology. Mind you, I am specifying on the term modern psychology primarily because psychology, as we know, existed from a long back, and there is a history of psychology even in the Indian religious texts. Now, we are not going to discuss about philosophy and the role of psychology and its role in religion and practice, and also in the other religious scriptures, but we are talking here, we are talking about experimental psychology. Now, it was seen that all these four people, that is Helmholtz, Weber, Fechner and Wundt, all were German scientists and who were either trained in physiology or were medical practitioners, and all were aware of the impressive developments in modern science. Now, what is important to see is they are all from Germany. Now, why Germany? Why was Germany taking such an important part in the development of modern psychology? One of the major reasons being that Germany was a country that encouraged different biological sciences considered the biological sciences as a scientific discipline and encouraged his experimentation. France and England, and especially the other European countries, were more keen on studying physical matter. So, to them, the sciences primarily meant studying the physical sciences, and biological sciences had not yet opened up so much in the other countries. And Germany, on the other hand, also expressed interest in aesthetics, in archaeology, in several other fields, and considered them phonetics and considered them as a part of science. Now, most of these physiologists, as you will see, would generally would become they had either practiced mathematics or physics along with medical science or physiology. Now that probably Germany, that's why, was the seed ground to develop psychology. It was a new discipline. It was it involved a lot of physiology and questions that could be answered by physiology. And so probably Germany was the ideal place to encourage this science. Now coming to the first person who had an influence in the development of psychology as a science, experimental science, is Hermann von Helmholtz. Helmholtz, strangely, had no idea that he would be so popular and so well known in the field of psychology. Helmholtz was a medical practitioner and he had served the army for more than 7 years. He was also he was a researcher in physics as well as physiology. Psychology ranked third in his area of scientific contribution. Yet he has been instrumental in the beginning of the new psychology. Helmholtz emphasized a mechanistic and deterministic approach, and he assumed that the human sense organs functioned like machines. Now look at this. There is this influence of physics and other scientific disciplines in these researchers, and you can actually see that psychology also had its other influences from physics. So Helmholtz used preferred using technological technical analogies, like comparing the transmission of nerve impulses to the operation of a telegraph. So it is strange that at those point in times work was more interdisciplinary than isolated and segregated into specific disciplines. Now Helmholtz's contributions have majorly involved investigations in speed of neural impulse, vision and hearing. Considering the speed of neural impulse, before Helmholtz people believed that the nerve impulse was instantaneous, that is, it traveled too fast to be measured. Now Helmholtz, through his experimentation, showed that the rate of conduction could be done by stimulating a motor nerve, and what he did was he attached the nerve to a muscle in the leg of a frog, and he recorded the precise moment of stimulation and of the resulting movement on the leg muscle of the frog. So this lag between the stimulation and the resultant response actually gave him an idea about the time taken for that for that nerve impulse to travel. So he found that he recorded the delay between the stimulation of the nerve near the muscle and the muscle's response, and stimulation further from the muscle. And these measurements yielded the conduction speed of the neural impulse to 90 feet per second. So Helmholtz not only experimented on frogs, but he also tried it out on human subjects. And what he did was he tried to find out the reaction time for sensory nerves in human subjects. So he studied the complete circuit for stimulation of a sense organ to a resulting motor response. And this is the first experiments, recorded experiments on reaction time that have been done. So students of psychology today, you must be well aware of Helmholtz's theories of vision and audition, which we'll come to later. But he was also, and you must be very familiar with reaction time experiments, but this is probably the first reaction time experiment recorded of the time, and this is way back in the 1800s, where reaction time of sensory nerves of human subjects were recorded by Helmholtz. Now, what was its implication for psychology? It seemed that Helmholtz's demonstration that the speed of conduction was not instantaneous, that is, it did not happen immediately, there was a delay, suggested that thought and movement follow each other at a measurable interval and do not occur simultaneously as has been thought. Helmholtz's work was one of the earliest instances of experimentation and measurement for a psychophysiological process. So as we said right now, that the very idea that thought and movement may be involved before a stimulus, before a response. This is probably the first experiment of its time that encouraged this theory. So, Helmholtz's experiments, though he conducted it from a physiologist's point of view, it has major implications in psychology. Now, as I was mentioning right now, Helmholtz investigated the external eye muscles and the mechanisms by which internal eye muscles focus on the lens, and many of us are well aware of young Helmholtz's theories of vision, and this was because it was published in 1802 by Thomas Young, and that is how we know it as. The theories of audition include the perception of tones, the nature of harmony and discord, and the problem of resonance. And again, Helmholtz is famous in the theories of vision as well as understanding the theories of audition. Now, how we have seen that his major investigations in understanding the neural impulse, vision and hearing contributed to the new psychology. How? He contributed a large important body of knowledge to study the human senses. So, before this we were studying the physiology in a more structured manner, where the human organism was not taken into account. This is the first time, first of its kind. Besides, his work helped strengthen the experimental approach to the study of topics that became central to the new psychology movement. In fact, even today, if you consider the textbooks of psychology, you will see that young Helmholtz's theory of vision and audition are still a part of our subject matter. Also, the reaction time experiments, though most of us did not know that Helmholtz has been responsible for carrying out conducting the first reaction time experiments, we still conduct reaction time experiments till date in psychology courses. That brings us to the next famous physiologist, Ernst Weber, who has a huge role in building up psychology, the new psychology movement. Weber earned his doctorate at the University of Leipzig in 1815 and taught anatomy and physiology there from 1817 till 1871. His primary interest, again like Helmholtz, was physiology of the sense organs, and he applied physiology's experimental methods to problems of a psychological nature. So, you see how the drift is coming on. So, earlier we were just studying physiology, the different structures of the human body, and now it has shifted to understanding the psychological mechanisms. So, there is a blend between, as we studied from empirical philosophers, that there is a blend between the psychology as well as the physiological methods, use of physiological methods to understand psychology. Now, Weber explored cutaneous senses and muscular sensations. Weber's experiments are very, very interesting, and till date we also carry it out in most of the psychology graduate classes. Now, one of the major questions that are answered, that were answered by Weber's experiments, were: what should be the difference between two points for us to be able to distinguish it as two sensations? Say, if I tell you that there are two points and I put it on my hand. So, what should be the distance if I put it together on my hand like this? So, what should be the distance between the two points for me to understand that these are two sensations? So, Weber was the first one to identify that there is a distance beyond which only we can understand two sensations. So, there is a threshold point beyond which we can discriminate two sensations. Otherwise, if it is close together and if these are considered as points, then if these are just single points, then it will be considered as one sensation instead of two. So, Weber experimentally determined the accuracy of the two point discrimination of the skin, that is, the distance between the two points that must be spanned, before subjects report feelings of two distinct sensations. So, without looking at the apparatus, which resembles like a drawing compass, basically this is the apparatus. Most of the psychology students must have seen this. This is like a compass or a divider, and there are two points, and it touches the skin at the same time. So, where basically the subjects are asked to report whether they feel a one-point sensation on the skin or a two-point sensation. So, when I am actually putting this on the skin like this, so are you understanding this? Is this a one point that is touching your skin, or is it 2 points? You can try this experiment on yourself at home. You can use a divider or a geometric box compass, and you please see that it does not hurt you, that the points are a little more blunt. I generally put sellotape on it, and it's very easily done, and you can put it together on a point. Just draw a straight line on your arm and see just whether, if it's very close, do you actually understand a 2-point sensation or a 1-point sensation. Then gradually start increasing the distance between the 2 points, and Weber showed that as the distance between the two sources of stimulation is increased, subject reports uncertainty. So, they are not really sure whether it is a 1 point or a 2 point, and after that a point is reached where they can clearly feel that there are two distinguishing stimulus present on their arm. So, we can see there is a point where it is expressed as one sensation. Then there is a point where it is expressed as a zone of uncertainty, and then there is a point where beyond which two sensations can be discriminated, or we can understand it as two sensations. So, basically Weber says that this is a threshold point from where you can understand that there exists more than one sensation. Weber's research marks the first systematic experimental demonstration of the concept of threshold. So, what is the threshold? It is a point at which a psychological effect begins to be produced. So, this is where human sensations come into being. So, this is where an individual may differ from another, where his threshold may be longer or more than another, or may be shorter than another. So, he can be more sensitive to 2-point sensations. So, his threshold can be shorter, for somebody else it can be longer. So, that is where the individual difference starts, and that is where the psychological effect begins to be produced. So, now that brings us, this was on distance. Next, Weber wanted to answer one more question, and here he went on to discuss how do we know one weight is heavier than another. And this question brought in the first psychology's first quantitative law. Okay. So, here what Weber studied was the just noticeable differences. Now, here I have a 100 grams weight and a 200 grams weight. So, how do I know that one is heavier than the other? So, what Weber did was, he asked his subjects to lift two weights. This is a standard weight and this is a comparison weight. So, this is the standard weight. As compared to this, you will see whether this is heavier or lighter or equal. So, I have another weight of 100 grams, this is 100, this is 100, and this is 200. So, the standard weight is 100 grams. So, I pick up the 100 grams and then I pick up the 200 grams and I say, oh, this is heavier. Similarly, I pick up the 100 grams and then this is a standard, and then I pick up the another 100 grams and I say, this is equal. Now, Weber wanted to answer this question. Why or how do we actually understand the difference in weights? So, here he saw that if there was a small difference between the weights, it resulted in the judging of sameness, judgments of sameness. But when there were large differences in weight, then the disparity between the weights could be understood. So, if the standard weight is 100 and this is 101, then it will not be possible for me to understand the difference. So, there has to be a certain difference in weight for me to understand that one is heavier than the other or one is lighter than the other. So, Weber found that this just noticeable difference between two weights was a constant ratio of 1 is to 40 of the standard weight. So, if this is a standard weight, then there has to be a difference of 1 is to 40. So, I will understand this only when there is a difference in ratio in this weight as compared to this of 1 is to 40. Otherwise, I will not be able to say. So, now let us just see an example. So, if there is a 41 grams reported to be just noticeable from a standard weight of 40 grams and an 82 grams just noticeable from a standard weight of 80 grams. So, say for if this was 40 grams, then I could perhaps notice the difference in 41. But if this was 80 grams, then I would not be able to notice the difference in 81. So, it would probably need to be 82 grams for me to understand the difference. Okay. So, if this was 120 grams, then probably this had to be 123 for me to understand the difference between the two. So, if this was 121 or 122, then both these weights would seem similar to me. Now, Weber realized with his experimentation with weights, Weber realized that muscle sensations also contribute to a person's ability to distinguish between the weights. Now, how does that happen? Weber saw that if you actually gave the weight to the individual by hand, so if you just put the weight in his hand and then this is a standard weight and then this is the comparison weight, the errors would be more. So, he would not be able to understand the differences so well as compared to if the individual was asked to pick up the weight and then pick up the next weight. So, then he would be able to understand the difference better. Now, here Weber said that the tactile or the touch sensation and the muscular sensations would actually contribute to understanding the would add on to the sensations and that would contribute to understanding the just noticeable differences in weight. So, when it is put on your palm, it is only the tactile stimulation and in fact, a little bit of pressure also. But when you are picking up the weight, so there is this change, there is this tactile stimulation also. You can understand the pressure. Once you are picking it up, the muscular sensations are also sent as input to the brain and that input is resulted as a feedback to the system telling us that, well, this is heavier, perhaps if I put this is heavier than this. So, Weber concluded that the internal muscular sensations in the first instance must have an influence on the individual's judgments. So, now what do we see? That we are talking of physical sensations or physiological sensations, but we see that this is the first time again that when physiologists are saying that the sensations are contributing to our understanding. Before this, Weber spoke of our psychological features, also psychological phenomena can be understood is a contributor in actually assessing things or perceiving things. So, what is Weber's contribution to psychology? We see that Weber suggested that discrimination among sensations depended not on the absolute difference between the two weights, but on their relative difference or ratio. So, what Weber suggested was the difference in weights is not because this is 100 grams and this is 101 grams. But how do we understand the difference in weight? It is by the difference in how we, what is the ratio between the their difference. Now, that is a constant. So, Weber's research showed that there does not exist a direct correspondence between a physical stimulus and our perception of it. His research provided a method for investigating the relationship between body and mind and between the stimulus and the resulting sensation. So, we spoke about the mind-body relationship in our previous class, and we see that the mind-body relationship is extended beyond just the philosophy books, but has come to experimentation. And this is after this we will see in Fechner's work that actually the establishment of psychophysics. So we are using stimuluses, and we are trying to interpret the stimulus and the sensation that it creates through psychological explanations. So, Weber's experiments stimulated additional research and focused the attention of later physiologists on the usefulness of the experimental method for studying psychological phenomena. So, as you can see that we move into the science of explaining psychological phenomena through experimentation. So, our course, this course on great experiments in psychology is to understand the different experiments that make psychology a science. And to start with, in the previous class, we studied about how philosophy and physiology, empirical philosophy and the positivist and the physiologist, they brought about this new movement in psychology. Today, we have discussed about Helmholtz and Weber and their contributions to this new science of psychology, and especially Germany's contribution primarily in the role of development of psychology. Hence, in the next class, we will move on to Titchener and his role in developing the science of psychophysics, and after that we will come to Wilhelm Wundt's role and Titchener's role in developing psychology as a science. So, I end today's lecture with the understanding that we have discussed about the primarily two major forces or major experimental researchers who have helped to build psychology as a science. Thank you.